Welcome this evening, straight after yesterday's general introduction to brain types in football. Welcome to Football Behavior Management, the company that makes footballers behave, but also makes staff behave. Because we're not only training staff, but we're also footballers, but also training the staff to actually pay attention and behave in a more desired way. Hi, Alami, nice to see you again here. So tonight the topic is the perfectionist brain type number one. We're doing a whole series on all nine brain types in the coming days, coming weeks. Yesterday, as I said, we had the general introduction to the whole neurogram model based on cybernetic big five theory. Hi Ben, good to see you also. If you missed it, of course you can watch the replay. It's online at footballbehaviormanagement.com, but I'll post the link in the my whole system falls apart, but never mind. Here it is, a general introduction of to the personality of football players based on cybernetic big five theory. If you haven't seen it yet, please go and watch it. Of course, we understand that there is no such thing as a personality. In reality, what we call personality is in reality evolutionary behavioral patterns. And we are going to discuss the evolutionary behavioral patterns of Pep Guardiola, or better yet, to understand how we discover that he has a brain type one. Of course, I did not work directly with Pep Guardiola, even though more and more I am working directly with superstar football players. But unfortunately, the situation is that I can either anonymize their reports and then send them to other interested parties within the world of football, or I can indicate which players I work with, but I can't do both because, of course, knowing their brain type is quite an advantage for the opponent. Aaron Monkey has a remark, but Pep Guardiola isn't even a football player, but he used to be a football player. He was actually a great player playing for Barcelona, and of course, and he has changed to manager. So we'll see that we're going to do a whole list. So Saturday, then we're going to do Ronaldo. Well, he's still playing football. Phew. But then afterwards, somewhere next week, we'll do Ruud Gullit, or as he's known in US speaking of in English speaking countries as Ruud Gullit. Then we're going to do Romario, who's currently a politician, but he used to be a great striker, of course, playing for PSV here in the Netherlands. Then we are going to do Marco van Basten, famous Dutch striker, but again, he's also out of football. Brain type six is very rare. I just have to look up the name, but I think from memory it's Cascarino. Nobody knows him. He is supposed to be a reasonably big star, but nobody heard of him. Then we're going to move to Maradona. Of course, he has a very interesting character for personality, Maradona. So we'll look into that. And then we're going to look into Luis Suarez. He's still playing, fortunately. And finally, we end with Messi, the best football player who ever lived. But indeed, currently Pep is not playing, but he has been playing as a defensive midfielder in Barcelona ages ago, because he is 50. So I think he stopped playing 20 years ago. And of course, it is also interesting to know the brain types of the manager. So for the Danish football agent that I'm working for, we're actually planning, because they have so big superstar talents that are now coming up and are really sought after by clubs, that they can make big demands for their players. And one of the things that they are thinking about is that they are going to ask for the brain types of the manager. Of course, if you're a talent, if you're 16, 17, 18 years old, and you want to make it big in football, then it's very important to find the right manager who can help you develop and grow and become a superstar. Because if you have the wrong manager, then of course there could be all kinds of issues. And one of those issues is actually that some brain types are quite incompatible with each other. Not in the long run, but in the short run. And what happens is that with certain combinations, then people will feel a kind of intuitive dislike for each other. And the problem, of course, is that managers, they do not use statistics. We have at Football Behavior Management, we have our own complete own Bayesian-based system for the football statistics. And then we can see which players are good and which players are bad. But we can also see what are the ideal starting 11 and stuff like that. And then you can see that sometimes the manager will play with a player who is a lot worse than other players in the team. And my theory, which we haven't tested yet, but it's my theory, is that sometimes this is due to an incompatibility of brain types. So what we do for the Danish football agent is that we hope that once we know all the brain types of all their players, that we can also ask clubs to actually have me interview the managers, check what kind of brain type the manager has, and see whether there's a match between the brain types between the player and the manager. And that's the reason why we're also very interested in the brain types of the managers. And in fact, we're actually also very much interested in the brain types of the whole staff, because of course you don't only deal as a player with the manager, but also with all the other members of the staff. And even within the football club, there's of course a lot of dealing with each other. And whenever you deal with other peoples, it is so handy to know the brain type of the others. So in my work for FC Twente, we are really moving towards to get FC Twente to start working with brain types, but primarily to start with all the staff members first. So that's a reason why we're not only looking into football players, even though Pep Guardiola is a famous football player, but a bit older than some of you. So that is the reason. So let's start with Pep Guardiola and see if we can find reasons to believe why he has a type 1 perfectionist brain. Well, look at how he's coaching. Some managers, they just put on an Adidas suit, meaning a tracksuit. But Pep Guardiola always has these perfect-looking outfits. He is considered the best-dressed manager in the world, I think. And of course, this is not typical for type 1 perfectionists, because type 1 perfectionists, they like to dress well. And they're not often dressed according to the latest fashion. Nevertheless, we'll have other reasons to discover that he has a type 1 perfectionist brain. Iron Monk says he looks like a type 3 to me. Yeah, that's a good observation. Absolutely. Yeah. So type 3 often wears suits. But in this case, he's actually having people look. He has people who buy the stuff for him. So he probably has some person as a paid position to actually make sure that he is dressed the best he can. Nevertheless, it is as a football manager, that is a very conscious choice. And I think that conscious choice is a hint that he is a perfectionist rather than a successful worker, type 3. But because if we look at how Ruud Gullit, for the Dutch people among us, looks. Uh, let's see if we can, who has most probably a type 3. Let me quickly come up with a picture. Okay. Well, not here. So here we have Ruud Gullit. And you can see, yeah, he's dressed nicely. He has also a tie, but he also has a jacket. Maybe it's a bit colder, but it is how he looks when he is as a manager running the team on the sideline. And of course, that is quite a distinction from Pep Guardiola, who actually looks like this when he is coaching from the sideline. And so normally, Iron Monkey, you're absolutely right. Ben finds it a fascinating distinction. So normally, if this was a general guy that I would not know what was his role, and I would not know his context, then indeed I would much more likely think, okay, this is a type 3 successful worker than type 1 perfectionist. But the fact that he is doing this as a manager, standing next to the pitch, actually coaching his team, that is much more unlikely as how type 3 successful workers would do it. Because then they might look more like this. This is the enthusiastic type 3 successful worker. But we'll get to that next week. But then we have already had a preview. Wrong button. So just a quick recap of the neurogram model for football players, in case you missed it yesterday. We now looked at 30 players that we know of, which we can reasonably probable have a good probability of discovering, knowing which kind of brain type they have. And then 22 out of 30 confirmed to the model. So that is a very nice statistically significant part. I'm not sure whether you can see the little one, but if you look to the right upper side of the inner Enneagram figure, that's our inspiration, even though we use cybernetic Big Five theory to explain it all, then you can see that the perfectionist is very high on social stability, also interested in defending, and very high on exploitation, which means passing. And the type 1 perfectionist scores very high on conscientiousness, which is the ability, the evolutionary behavioral pattern of protecting your long-term goals against short-term impulses. And it is hardly readable, I think, but maybe we can enlarge it a bit. No, we can't enlarge it. That's a pity. Maybe this way. No, it will only make things worse. And you have to take it on my account. But the two aspects of perfectionism, of the perfectionist, are industriousness, you have to work hard, and orderliness, you have to be very tidy in your work. But when stressed, then the perfectionist moves to with the line down to the 4. It becomes antagonistic, belligerent, and callous. Not callous, it's belligerent, and the negative version of enthusiasm. So it means he becomes a fighter, but the enthusiasm is that there's too much emotions going on. But when he moves from the 1 to the 7, then he actually comes across to open for reasoning, and he is able to be a combination of rebelling, doing things differently than other people, and being able to play the second fiddle. So let's see if we can find these things online that confirm this picture of the perfectionist, and that confirm that he has a type 1 successful type 1 perfectionist brain. Well, here's an article on Pep Guardiola's. He has the predicament, the cons of being a perfectionist. He is known in the business of football as being a perfectionist. But here we get into the problem. But it was a quote of Nietzsche, so I could not, as a Nietzschean philosopher myself, I could not leave this passage of not included. Convictions are more dangerous enemies of truth than lies. That's also my viewpoint. Convictions convict. If people are absolutely certain, then they have the inability to adapt when there is data that shows that it is time to adapt. It's called rigidity. I did not explain that yesterday, but I did for today. I have added another version of the neurogram model, because we have yesterday we've seen that you have these axes. So in case of Pep Guardiola, he is in his normal. There are three states or three ways that the brain works. That is basically we have behavior, evolutionary behavioral patterns that are involved in stress. We have neutral evolutionary behaviors, and we have relaxation, relaxed evolutionary behavioral patterns when someone is relaxed. So we have this dynamic going on. That was all I'm explaining with the move to the 4 and the 7. And so we have this axis where, on the one hand, Pep Guardiola scores very high on conscientiousness. He's very good at being able to set a long-term goal and stick to it and protect that long-term goal against short-term impulses. And he scores very low on disinhibition, is the other side. But you can actually, this is the axis as discussed yesterday in the general introduction. But this is scoring high on conscientiousness. This is scoring low. But they're actually the axis or the spectrum is even a little bit bigger. So if you look at a little bit bigger, then you can actually score too high on conscientiousness or too low on conscientiousness. So hopefully this is clear. So the evolutionary behavioral patterns, they're actually a set of four on a continuum, on a spectrum, going from too high to high to too low to too low. At the moment it becomes too high and too low, then we're actually going to get into psychopathologies, and that is the next sheet. Here you can see that a person with a type 1 perfectionist brain has the tendency or the risk, or that there are little aspects in his evolutionary behavioral patterns of obsessiveness and compulsiveness. And of course, the other things are acting compulsively and being inflexible. And of course, the too much efficiency, too much exploitation ends up in rigidity. And but these psychopathologies are only in the case, that's according to the definition of cybernetic Big Five theory, if people are unable structurally to achieve their goals. Now, Pep Guardiola is quite capable, is very successful as a player and very successful as a manager. So he is very capable of achieving his goals. So there's no question whether Pep Guardiola suffers from psychopathology. That's not the case at all. He's perfectly capable of achieving his goals. Nevertheless, you can see that the rigidity, the inflexibility, the compulsiveness, the obsessiveness is all part of the evolutionary behavioral patterns that he is displaying. Because we can read about it. Often one's greatest strength could also be his greatest vulnerabilities. Throughout his managerial career, it was Pep Guardiola's philosophy that stands him out from the pack and rendered him as a top coach in Spain, Germany, and now England. Yet, on different occasions, Pep appeared to be the victim of his own ideology and be relentless about about how he wants his philosophy to apply it. Aside from his first season in England, Guardiola has now enjoyed non-stop successes since he started at Barcelona with his 14 titles in the first 3 years as a coach, moving to Germany to be the manager of reigning champion Bayern München, with a totally different ambience, where he added another 8 titles to his name. That is all how good he is. Then Guardiola's most recent destination has been Manchester City, where things got off to a bad start. He was severely criticized in his first season for the way he wants to play his football in the Premier League. Everyone except Pep came to the realization that his philosophy won't fit English football, but he was adamant that he wouldn't change his mind about his philosophy. And here you can see that he won't change his mind about his philosophy. This is the person scoring high on conscientiousness. This is the person says, no, this is my goal. It's a long-term goal. I'm going to stick with it, and I'm going to protect it against short-term impulses. Guardiola was stubborn in his philosophy, but not in execution. In the next couple of seasons, he managed to prove that his philosophy could be applied under any circumstance. He didn't succumb to the pressure. After modifying some details in his philosophy, he started to achieve what everyone else dreams of. Record-breaking Premier League wins followed, which established him as one of the finest coaches to have graced the Premier League. And so there you see it, and he was capable of protecting his long-term goal and then actually achieved it, but a little bit later than his critics demanded, which of course is more of the case. And also here in this article, you have the same line of thought. Now, Guardiola's philosophy is extremely brilliant, but his rigidity may prove his own undoing. So let's go back to the model. And you can see, so the type 1 perfectionist is in the right top corner near conscientiousness. You can see it is part of the exploitation quarter. And if we do too much of it, it becomes rigidity, exactly as how the model predicts. And you can see that that is also how journalists perceive Pep Guardiola. But more interesting, what they said following is that modern football requires both attacking panache and defensive discipline, and his blueprint seems to be deficient in the latter regard. And so it's lacking attacking panache. During his press conference after the Barcelona game, Pep insisted that he will stick with his style and that he'd rather go home than change it. But you can see what the important part here was is that his playing style has a lot to do with passing the ball around. It is all about possession, because the philosophy is if you possess the ball, you can't lose. If you have 100% possession, then you simply can't lose. You don't necessarily win, because it could well be a draw, but at least you do not lose. And of course, if you go back to the model, that is exactly what the model predicts. Because if you look at the football part, you can see that the type 1 perfectionist is also very much into social stability. Conscientiousness can also be seen as a stability of long-term goals, but it's also quite near social stability. And you can see social stability is actually a team effort. Defending is something that you do with the whole team. And so the ability to be part of the team, be part of the group, is very important for defending. And you can see that what is the idea of passing the ball around is to actually exploit errors by the opponent. So you can see that the whole defending and passing game of Pep Guardiola is pretty much in line with what you would think a person with his brain type would come up with. It is the ideal combination of two of the four principles of football, defending and passing. And that is exactly what Pep Guardiola, his philosophy is about. So again, you can see that the preference of the manager for a certain type of football, of course, has also to do what he learned and how he, from all the personal experiences and associative and instrumental learning. But you can see that the brain type of the manager also plays a important part in deciding what kind of football his team is going to play. So let's see. Let's look at the clip of Pep Guardiola actually managing his team. Here we go.
Ending off as a major blow to the city, increasing the tension at half time.
Guys, keep going. That's what they want. Sit down. Nobody talk. Sit down. Drink water and relax.
So that's the least relaxing way of telling people to relax. Guardiola is the guy who comes in and said, sit down and shut up. And then says to everybody, wait, drink water and relax. But he says it in such a angry voice because he is pissed off. And this is, of course, typical for type 1 perfectionists, is that there are anger types. The anger goes to the inside of the person. They're quite angry at themselves, but then also let this anger go to the outside. And of course, it is really controlled. So the important part about the perfectionist is that it's a control freak. They want to control every little detail. So they also keep themselves under control. So I'll run the clip by once more. So you can see how much under control, even though he's extremely angry, how much he's still under control of himself, and how he's trying, actually achieving, to control his whole team. So that is a very nice example of the angry version of the type 1 perfectionist. Let me see if I... There was a second clip that I, of course, forgot to bookmark. It was not the smartest thing to do, but I can look it up in the history, hopefully. No, we're only going to see all the... Oh, maybe that is the... No, this is the same clip. Then check.
Will change.
Yes.
So now we'll make way for full.
Okay. That's my bad. Maybe it... I could have found it elsewhere. Nevertheless, that is typical, the anger for the type 1 perfectionist. So we've already seen the perfectionist. And now we're going into looking into the anger issues. But also here we have a number of quotes. Pep Guardiola doesn't demand much of his players, just perfection. What I want, my desire, is to have 100% possession. So just the quote that I just repeated. He said after his team had just completed a comprehensive 5-1 win over Arsenal in the Champions League. And so this is, you have to figure out that type 1 perfectionist is also criticizing everyone and himself in particular. So in this case... he has actually won by a large margin. For the US viewers, for soccer, winning 5-1 in two matches. Over two matches is quite a big achievement, especially at that level. So you would guess that the Manager would be happy with such a result, and most managers would be, but of course the perfectionist would not be. The perfectionist is someone who has this standard for himself that is very high, and if he achieves his own standard, then he will not be happy. Instead, he will just be thinking that his standard was too low, and he will make sure that the standard is even approved even more. So that's what you can see here. And you would think, okay, winning 5-1 is very good for a team. Let's be happy. But no. There was not 100% possession, which is impossible, just to be clear. I'm still trying to see if I can find the other clip. So that is typical for perfectionists. Okay, we did good, but that's not good enough. We want to do much better. We already seen it there, that the philosophy is extremely brilliant, but this rigidity may improve his undoing, and he will stick to his style no matter what. So here we have an interview with one of the trainers that was visiting by. Ben asks, why do you not like the acronym OCEAN? Well, I have nothing wrong with the acronym OCEAN. I can very well live with the acronym OCEAN. So OCEAN stands for openness, conscientiousness, extraversion, agreeableness, neuroticism, which is the big five. There's no issue with that. It's just that it somehow did not make it to my brain cells. And after observing how Guardiola manages the club, Kocak says he can see why the Spaniard has found so much success everywhere he has gone. He's very warm, humble, and respectful person who is always nice and polite to me as well. Kocak told Cole and Spox, well, that also fits very well with the model, because I'm not sure whether you can read it, but if you can see, so I have conscientiousness, and if you go to the 12 o'clock position of the of the model, then you see agreeableness, and agreeableness has two aspects, compassion and politeness. And if you have the two aspects of the perfectionist, industrious and orderliness, then actually there are two subtypes, a more agreeable perfectionist and a more open for experience perfectionist. And it's highly likely that Pep Guardiola is more of the agreeable perfectionist. Why? Because he thinks politeness and compassion are important. So more important probably than assertiveness and enthusiasm. So being polite is also absolute in the neighborhood of the type 1 perfectionist, exactly as the model predicts. So he's warm, humble, and respectful person, also nice and polite to me as well. He has a clear plan of football, and here it comes, absolutely obsessed with details and doesn't let fate decide over anything. So that's also, of course, according to the model. So this is the conscientiousness, protecting long-term goals against short-term impulses. But if you do too much of it, then it becomes obsessive-compulsive. And that industriousness, if you do that too much of it, it also becomes acting compulsively. And so, again, this is psychopathologies for people who fail to achieve their goals structurally. Of course, that is not in question at all when it comes to Pep Guardiola, who does achieve his goals structurally. Nevertheless, you can see these small issues still in the character of, or in the evolutionary behavior of Pep Guardiola. However, he's also not uptight and jokes with the team. And of course, this is also important, because if you look at the model, and we already discussed this, when perfectionist type 1 relaxes, then he moves towards type 7, the hedonist or the epicurean, the person who enjoys life. And here starts to explore how much fun and how much party you can party in life. So somehow that is also part of the evolutionary behavioral patterns of Guardiola. So let's see if we can find the clip displaying that. Well, yes, we can. Here we go. So there he is, partying like a madman, exactly as a relaxed type 1 perfectionist would do. He moves towards the type 7 hedonist or epicurean, and he will display evolutionary behavioral patterns that are all about making fun, ignoring problems, and just party like a madman, like I said. And where the type 7 epicurean or hedonist can actually go wrong at it, can also go quite well, of course, that the relaxed type 1 perfectionist has no problems with it at all. He can party as much as he wants without any problem. So far, all the indications are clearly that Pep Guardiola has a type 1 perfectionist brain, scoring high in conscientiousness most of the time, but also being able to relax and party. Any questions so far? Do people have any questions, remarks? Or is it clear why I think that Pep Guardiola has a type 1 perfectionist brain? Give people some time to react. Well, Dr. Ben Max has fantastic real-world examples. Okay, great. Well, we're going to have 8 more of them. The next being Saturday. Tomorrow, for our Dutch audience, there will be... put typing in a video title like this, please. Okay, I'll see if I can sneak it in somewhere. Thank you for that feedback. Tomorrow at 7, we have Philosophy TV. Typing is money worth. Well, let's see. In the world of football, it works quite differently, I'm afraid. But I'll sneak it in somewhere. Tomorrow at 7, for my Dutch viewers, we have Philosophy. We're going to do a whole stream on cause and effect. The philosophy of cause and effect. But Saturday we're back with with brain type 2 of Ronaldo. So if you like football players, then we have a real football player. We're going to see why I think that Ronaldo has a type 2 helper brain. And then Sunday we have our daily or weekly session with Nora Lisa. We're going to discuss why some people think she has a type 6 brain, well, in reality, she has a type 8 brain. It's a common mistake many so-called Enneagram experts make. And then on Monday, I'm probably going to do fake NLP. I'm going to discuss something. I still have to look into what. And then Tuesday, Tuesday is also interesting for the English speaking, because it's going to be an English stream on Tuesday. We're going to analyze a speech of Biden. My Dutch audience is very much interested why Biden is doing what he is doing. And they want me to analyze one of his speeches on Afghanistan and to see if he's trying to hypnotize us or not. And I have not looked or heard the speech yet. I did get the link, so we do have the link. It's a 20-minute speech. We'll look at it at Tuesday at 7. And then Wednesday, we have Ruud Gullit, type 3 brain, my type. So I relate very well with Ruud Gullit. So thank you for watching. And hopefully I see you back tomorrow if you're Dutch, and otherwise Saturday when we are back in English. Bye, 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 bye. See you next time.